How many of you have made flan before? Not me.
I did a little trial run in preparation, and this is my second time.
Overachiever. Kevin is the overachiever because he practiced. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Chemists in the Kitchen. And today we will be making flan. Yummy, 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 yummy flan, right? We thought it would be really interesting to focus on the reason why the recipe always suggests use a water bath. And half of the flan is gonna go inside a water bath and half of them are going to go straight onto the oven rack. Will we have evenly baked flan or will we have a disaster of scrambled eggs and something that looks like flan? I cannot wait to see what happens today.
My name is Kevin Aptowicz. I'm a professor at physics at Westchester University.
Hi, I'm Julie Pollock, and I am an associate professor of chemistry and biochemistry at the University of Richmond.
Hi, everybody. I'm Daisy Rosas Vargas, and I am a science communicator here in Southern California.
So if you go and look up a recipe for flan, one of the most important things, no matter what ratio of egg to milk that they tell you to do, they're gonna tell you to put it into the oven in a water bath. And today our question is, do we really need that water bath? And if the answer is yes, we wanna talk about the science of why we need that water bath.
So what is a water bath?
A water bath is basically a tub of water that you're gonna put whatever it is that you're baking into it. It's going to allow it for good heat transfer, as well as keeping our temperature at a very regulated temperature within the oven itself.
So when we're making flan, it doesn't require that much in ingredients. You need some, I just have a big container of sugar here. We're gonna be using some eggs, so I have 3 eggs. The specialty ingredients, for me at least, are the condensed milk and the evaporative milk, and some vanilla extract. And that's it. That's all we need for our recipe today.
So how many of you have made flan before?
Not me. This is my first experience, Daisy, and so I'm glad that we have you as an expert to help us walk through it.
So yeah, I have made regular flan as well, traditional flan. However, I have not made them in ramekins.
I like that. Trademark it. I don't know if you guys would be willing to join me, but whenever I talk about eggs cooking in class, I just can't help but kind of do my denaturing dance.
I love it. Let's do it.
So it's not gonna be a TikTok thing, but I know. Imagine my arm is my protein. So proteins are a nice long chain of amino acids, right? And so they form this long chain. But then in the eggs, in their natural state, their native state, they're all curled up.
Right.
They're in a ball.
Yep,
okay.
Got it.
So they're floating around. Most of egg whites, for example, is water, and they have these little balls of protein that are floating around. And now we're gonna heat up that egg white, right? So we're heating up the egg white, and as we heat it, it's jiggling more, right? Because the water molecules are banging into it, it's jiggling more, and then they begin to unravel, right? And so that unraveling is called denaturing. And then they bond with neighbor proteins, and that's called coagulation, and that forms up our structure. And so what the water bath does is it allows for the gradual denaturing and coagulation of those egg proteins and sets up a nice gel. Without the water bath, you can quickly denature them. It can actually even form too many bonds, and you can begin to squeeze the water out and it begins to get dry. By the way, you guys did an excellent job.
Hooray!
Of the protein denaturing dance.
Let's get started with our sugar component. So we're gonna try to make a caramel, but making some really nice sugar and turn it into like this golden brown amber.
All right, so this part, right, we're making that caramel gooey that's gonna go over the top of our flan. And so we have to take our white sugar and caramelize it as much as we can, which means we're oxidizing it, right? So we're oxidizing all the sugars and we're hoping not to burn it.
I think you definitely want to stir in case there's a hot spot in your pan.
That's what I was thinking. Mine is chunky too. I mean, it's definitely like ice that's melting in some capacity, but it's definitely getting that color. This is so neat. Woo. So the composition of this table sugar that we're using is actually two sugars or two carbohydrates that are linked with one another. It's fructose and glucose. And when those heat, once they've melted, then they start doing chemical reactions, which are caramelization reactions, which are oxidation reactions. So they actually change the chemical structure of the molecule, which changes the oxidation state, which actually is what changes the color. It's what gives it that flavor, that scent that you can actually smell as we're melting it, as well as the colors. Oh goodness, I think I'm getting there, yeah. Daisy.
Oh.
It's because there's some chunkies on my spatula as I'm pulling it out. Okay. It's like there's some chunks on
my. Perfect. No, I think that looks good.
So should I put it into my ramekins?
Yes, pour it into
your
ramekins.
So just kind of divide it into my ramekins. Mmm, it's good. I mean, it really tastes kind of like cotton candy. How's yours looking, Daisy?
My ramekin was so cold, it cracked the ramekin.
Oh no!
I heard a crack. Look,
oh,
I don't know
gosh.
If you can see it. Right there.
Oh my gosh, yes! Oh my gosh!
Right there.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, yours looks good.
Yours looks so good. Mine are so much darker.
Mine looks darker.
You can tell who the expert is.
Yeah, that looks good.
Mine looks like chocolate almost.
Should we get to the next step?
All right, yes, okay. What are we doing, Daisy?
We are gonna make our custard filling. We're gonna mix everything. We're gonna mix our eggs, our condensed milk, our sweetened condensed milk, and our evaporated milk.
Yep.
So shake
them. And vanilla, right? And some vanilla?
And vanilla, yes, and vanilla.
Well, I just got an egg shell. There we go. Okay, got that out.
I just want to make sure that my eggs are incorporated very well, especially like the yolk, right?
Yep. You don't want to do too much like to mess up the proteins, right? Because we want the protein structure to still be there because that's what's going to give our gel that consistency. And the more you whisk it, the more you can actually start to break down the proteins that are in the milk, and then that can change the texture. I'm making a little bit of a disaster, I'm not gonna lie. I'm gonna show it. I got some air bubbles in mine. I hope that's okay. And so, then how far up do we go with it? Do we go basically as high as the ramekin, or?
We have this like outer rim on our ramekin, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I would maybe do like a tad under that.
Just as an example, I have mine all ready to go right in the oven with no water.
Yep.
And then I have three of them that are going to be in a water bath that I'm, so I'm going to fill this up with water and put that in the oven.
I'm going to get my water in and hopefully not get it all over my ramekins. This is also another test of getting in my hot water here. Oh gosh. Tricky. So in terms of a water bath, you probably have seen this in a variety of different types of recipes. A lot of people do this for cheesecake and other baked goods that need to be baked for a long period of time, kind of at a lower temperature. And part of that is because it allows for even heating. If we think about how our ovens work, they're dry heat, the air is moving slightly around in it, but the water bath allows it to be able to have a complete even heating as well as an even heating. That's why we fill it up towards the top of the ramekin so that even heat transfer can happen through the liquid.
If they're in a water bath, we know there's a limit. They can't get above the boiling temperature of water. Right, so they're not gonna get above that 212 degrees. So it's both an even heat, but it also sets an upper limit on how hot our ramekins get. So we can kind of cook them at a more steady, even heat that doesn't go above 212 degrees Fahrenheit.
So that's the theory behind it. And I feel like every single flan recipe that you read, you have to do this. And so really the question is it really gonna be that much better if we do it with a water bath? Or can you skip over the water bath and not worry about dumping water on your floor when you're trying to pull it out of the oven or put it into the oven? You know, like, is it worth it or not, right? That's kind of the question that we're asking here. Like, theoretically it makes sense, but like, do we have to actually do it? I don't know. That's the question. Do it. Oh, goodness gracious. Oh my gosh, they look.
Oh.
My one Whoa. That is not in the water bath looks super cooked.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Does yours look so cooked? My other one looks still pretty raw though.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna go ahead and pull this out so that people can see.
Oh, mine are wiggly.
I mean, mine, it almost rose.
Wiggle.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, yours is caramelized on the top.
Yeah. Wiggle, oh, wiggle, wow. Wiggle, 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 wiggle.
So if you need to quickly make flan, don't use a water bath.
I guess, yeah. My water bath ones look not as cooked. I'm gonna rotate my pan in my oven though.
All right, how much time has passed, Julie?
We have done just over 55 minutes. So should we check on the water
bath? Yes.
Yeah, let's do it. Okay.
Ooh.
Oh, they're more set for sure. Oh gosh. Do yours look like they puffed up as much as the non-water bath ones?
No, nowhere near as much.
Yeah, that's what I would say. Also, my non-water bath ones have shrunk in now. Mine have completely collapsed.
So we should take them out of the water bath to stop probably the...
Stop the cooking. I get mostly vanilla. Oh man, it smells delicious though.
So those proteins, probably more of them shook loose and bonded with each other, forming a more solid gel.
So we have waited for 2 hours. They've been in the fridge for 2 hours. We're gonna take them out. So we're gonna compare them. So
let's try, okay. Oh, it's coming, oh my gosh. Oh, I still have so much caramel in my thing. It came out though. It kind of looks a little gross though.
Yeah. So
my edges are
like ugly. Yeah, ugly.
Oh, sure.
It looks like almost like a rice cake or something.
Mine looks kind of smooth.
Mine looks a little bit more like it's smooth but also a little scrambled eggy.
Here,
Daisy
let me show you this
doing.
One.
Do you
Look
see
this.
That? But there's some parts of it that are smooth. Like this part is smooth, but then there's like holes. Okay.
Mine looks good. It looks like a normal.
Yes, mine looks very smooth.
Mine looks.
Look.
I had part that was
this
like.
This looks much.
Mine looks better.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, mine looks. Oh, that looks so much better. So much smoother. Look at the caramel. Like, look at the caramel dripping down.
You could definitely see that the one without the water bath, the caramel looks overcooked even more.
Yep.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's true for yours, but it definitely kept cooking.
This is just like beautiful top. Yeah, for sure. Different color difference. All of us.
Now, does it impact taste?
Does it impact taste? Okay.
Let's try the bathless one first.
The unbathed one.
How easy should your spoon go through it? It does feel
pretty. A little bit. It could be smoother.
My texture is. A little bit, like the texture is a little scrambled eggsy.
Yes.
No, this is not good.
No, it reminds me of like if we really had a thick omelet.
Yes. Yep.
Yeah.
All right, are we ready?
Okay.
Yes.
Let's do it.
So immediately looks smoother.
Yeah. I don't notice that overcooked bottom layer either. Mine's more caramely.
Yeah, mine's much smoother. I mean, the taste profile is similar, but the texture is really different.
That's good.
I mean, it's significantly better than the best.
Significantly better.
I'm just like looking at the inside of it, and it's just so much better. It's like not even crumbling.
So, do we need a water bath?
I would say I wish we had done one without the water bath, and 5 in the water, because I think to answer your question, Daisy, you need the water bath. You can trust all of the years of experience of the people who have made flan before us that have told us to use a water bath, that yes, it needs to happen. And I think we kind of have seen it makes sense for the science. Like you can tell that the outside of the non-water bath cooked too fast, those proteins got too fast.
They just
and scrambled, and the middle actually was pretty good. So like the rest of it insulated the outside of it, insulated the inside, that turned out pretty good. But also it just cooked so much faster, but it just didn't give you that look of what a flan looks like or should look like.
You guys did really good.
Thank you, Daisy. It's fine. And just remember, you're flantastic. If you made it all the way to this end of this video.
You're flantastic.